Hi everybody. Today I will be talking about multi-system inflammatory syndrome, a mysterious illness which has been tied to COVID and kids. Now, as this COVID pandemic is continued, what we have seen is that our children are more likely to remain asymptomatic or have a milder disease. However, they are playing a very important role in ongoing transmission of the disease. Now, what has happened? It was across the world. Many public health officials reported there was an increased incidence of pediatric multisystem inflammatory syndrome cases in children, which seems to be temporarily associated with COVID-19. And somehow they bear a resemblance to Kawasaki-like disease. Now let's see what is being said in literature. Now this article was published in Lancet on May 7, 2020. This was an unprecedented cluster of 8 children reported from London. After a week, a similar case series was reported from Italy, from Bergamo province. Now, the underlying similar characteristic of these children were they all had fever with elevated inflammatory markers, and they were having clinical manifestations which were similar to atypical Kawasaki disease, Kawasaki shock syndrome, or toxic shock syndrome. The other important thing was that these cases were being reported from the places where the overall incidence of COVID was very high. Now, just to classify this disease, CDC says that it is probably a multisystem inflammatory syndrome in children, and for the sake of surveillance, they laid down certain criteria to identify these illness. The features included persistent fever, multi-organ involvement, and elevated inflammatory markers. The other important concern was that this disease is being seen in children even after 1 to 4 weeks of the exposure to SARS-CoV-2. Now, why is it so? So if you will look at the pathophysiology of COVID-19 infection, you will appreciate that in the first stages, that is in stage 1 and stage 2, is being represented by a blue box. This is a phase where there is a lot of viral load or viral replication is happening. And then the immune system which comes into play is first the innate immunity and then the adaptive immunity of our body, which either curbs the infection or there occurs a dysregulated or abnormal immune response responsible for causing this hyperinflammatory state, which is characterized by cytokine storm. So that may be the reason that we are able to detect antibodies to coronavirus in these children, and these children were negative for RT-PCR, but that was not true for all cases. So as pediatrician, we all know that how Kawasaki disease manifests. So this Kawasaki disease, which is usually characterized by high grade fever and other characteristic features, including rash, is it linked with COVID-19? So the question is whether this virus is responsible for causing Kawasaki disease or it is causing some kind of an inflammatory syndrome, which is resembling Kawasaki disease. As this debate continued, there is another large case series was published in JAMA. This case series constituted 58 children of PIMS from London, and it says that this PIMS seems to have some properties which are different from other pediatric inflammatory entities like Kawasaki. So here the kids were usually older. Their age was more than 5 years. This syndrome somehow have some affinity for cardiovascular system, and around 50% of these kids presented with cardiogenic shock. and there was a marked or greater any unusual elevation of the inflammatory markers, which is usually seen in macrophage activation syndrome. So just to summarize this, probably we are dealing with a Kawasaki-like illness along with circulatory dysfunction, which is being treated in the past as Kawasaki disease shock syndrome. This Kawasaki disease shock syndrome has not been so common. I'm sure that all of us would remember Kawasaki disease not as Kawasaki disease shock syndrome. However, there was also a lot of GI involvement in the form of abdominal pain, diarrhea, and vomiting, and elevated inflammatory markers suggestive of macrophage activation syndrome, which is seen in the form of high ferritin. The platelet counts, which is another differentiating feature from Kawasaki. In Kawasaki, you would see usually a increasing trends of platelet. Here, the platelets would be either normal or would be on the lower side. Then talking about TLC count, you can see leukocytosis or in sometimes leukopenia. But the other important feature was decrease in the lymphocyte count, which would suggest a severity of a disease. So these children would have neurological signs too. They would have redness of the eyes. They would have red and cracked lips, cervical lymphadenopathies, skin rash, fever for more than 4 days, and left ventricular dysfunction in almost all of the cases. It can be mild or it can be severe. Some children were resuscitated with just fluid, some children requiring inotropic support. Now talking about coronary involvement, it was not so common as was seen in the Kawasaki previously. Then there was a GI involvement also. And in fact, some of the children presented with just severe abdominal pain. They were taken for OTs, done endoscopies and all that. Now, if whatever literature I have gone through, what I could find is that if you need to identify this disease, then there are some features which have to be there. That included your persistent fever. Some of the important inflammatory markers were neutrophilia, elevated CRP, lymphopenia, then involvement of single or multiple organs. Additional features would include features suggestive of Kawasaki disease. You should be able to exclude the other causes of inflammatory shock syndrome. The like microbial cause has to be excluded. Then you should test these children for RT-PCR and IgM and IgG, depending upon the clinical course. Now, the worker for these patients would include your CBC, LKFT, D-dimers, CRP-SR, LDH, ferritin, troponin, pro-BNP. The specific test obviously would include your RT-PCR, IgM, IgG, imaging chest X-ray. So when talking about chest X-ray, in most of these children, you may not find any infiltrates in the chest X-ray. However, some of these children would have. But the chest findings or the chest symptoms are not so much that they would require or they would behave like adults. You know, the hypoxia was not significant in any of these cases. The sickness was because of multi-organ involvement or cardiac dysfunction, mainly cardiac dysfunction. So echo was a very important investigation, and ultrasound should be done to rule out any other cause of abdominal pain. The management would include the supportive care as the mainstay of treatment. One has to be cautious about using fluids because it is an inflammatory syndrome. Then the other important thing is the use of a steroid, especially if you have diagnosed cardiac dysfunction. Then antibiotics could be used as per hospital policy. The specific treatment would include IVIG and tocilizumab. Now, talking about IVIG, the IVIG should be started in all these cases. Tocilizumab. What is tocilizumab? It is an IL-6 receptor antagonist. So, in these cases, IL-6 levels should be done, and if the IL-6 levels are persistently high and are not decreasing even after IVIG, we can give a trial of tocilizumab. It has been seen that if the IL-6 remains high then it is a poor prognostic marker for the COVID disease. This was the two case reports which were being published in Indian Pediatrics. These two case reports are from South India. The above one was from Kanchikamati, Chennai. And in this, the child was RT-PCR positive. He was 5 years and he was given both IVIG and later on tocilizumab. And this, another case report from Calicut, the RT-PCR was negative, but the features were entirely suggestive of multisystem inflammatory syndrome, and this child responded well to steroid and IVIG. And they have stored the sera for antibody screening. Now, this was a case which came to our hospital. This was a 13-year-old child, had a fever for 4-5 days, had rash. You can see that there was abdominal pain, vomiting, redness, red lips and tongue, presented in shock. Saturations were maintained. COVID-19 was positive. LVF was 30%, and inflammatory markers in the form of CRP was high. The IL-6 was 510. D-dimers were significantly high. Tropi was 158. Ferritin was 942. And you can look at the platelets, which were just 1.4 lakhs. So management included inotropic support as well as the ventilatory support in the form of non-invasive ventilation. However, this child responded beautifully to specific therapy, including IVIG, which we gave in the doses of 2 gram per kg. Steroid, we started on methylprednisolone and 2 mg per kg per day for 5 days, is followed by tapering doses for next 2 weeks. Then aspirin was also given as an anticoagulant, as there is a lot of, as the D-dimers were high. So even for initial 3 days, we gave enoxaparin, and later on aspirin was continued. Now, with the this is the Indian data as of June 24, 2020. This was basically collected by Dr. Jhuma Shankar. She is a professor in pediatric critical care in Delhi, and Dr. Bala Ramachandran, who is a director of pediatric critical care, Kachikamati, Chennai. So they both have collated the data from different pediatric ICUs, and they found that till now in India, our colleagues have seen around 17 of such cases. So I will just conclude that children, we may be seeing more of such children as we are plateauing towards the COVID cases. And the other important point is that we should always keep a very high index of suspicion if we come across a child who's having persistent high grade fever, who has elevated inflammatory markers, or there's some evidence of organ involvement. Then how can we correlate it to COVID? It is not always that they should be RT-PCR positive or the antibody testing positive, but if they have a history of being in contact with a lab confirmed case, or even if they are coming from high risk area, we should say that probably we are dealing with multisystem inflammatory syndrome. Thank you guys. Stay safe. Personal safety is a priority.